Hey folks, welcome to WFTDA.tv on Twitch. I am your host, Diarrhea, and you're watching Collab Lab, a show dedicated to highlighting creators from the Derby community in a collaborative platform. This week, I have two very special guests to introduce. This is Sawa, also known as Sweet N Sawa. She is my co-host today, my BFF, my line mate, and my knitting extraordinaire. Sawa's been involved with roller derby since 2014 and knitting for many, many years.
I started crocheting with my grandmother. We'd watch Jeopardy together.
There you go.
And she'd yell at the contestants and talk to Alec.
So
Trebek and
Alex Trebek.
I'd make little, yeah. Wow. So nervous. I'd make snakes, and then I learned how to knit from Martha Stewart Living.
So everybody, welcome Sweet N Sawa to the hosting gig today. Next up, we are going to be joined by the amazing Toni Carr, better known as Joan of Dark. Joan was born and raised in Indiana and a longtime member of Naptown Roller Derby. She's a coffee shop owner, true geek, knitting extraordinaire. Please welcome Joan of Dark. Hi,
Hi.
Joan.
Hello.
We're very excited for you to be here.
I'm excited to be here. This is very fun.
Well, thank you for joining us on Collab Lab. I'm ready to talk about roller derby, coffee, geekery, and knitting. How about you?
I'm so ready.
Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Let's do it. So for those of you who may not know who you are, why don't you go ahead and just take a few moments to tell those who are watching, just give us kind of your origin story. I know you've been involved with roller derby for a really long time. So why don't you just let us know how you got started?
We were literally hanging out at my coffee shop with Strawberry Jam and Sweet C. And we were talking about this like TV show called Roller Girls, which followed one of the Texas teams. And we were like, there's nothing like that in Indiana. We're looking all over Google. And Strawberry Jam started up a MySpace page for, at the time it was called Crossroads Roller Derby. And she was like, I'm just going to do it. And my husband was sitting there and he was like, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. You're going to get hurt. And he was right. I totally jacked up my shoulder and my knees and everything else. But he also was like, well, if you're going to do it, then I'm going to do it too. So he started up trying to ref and said that was too hard. And then he tried coaching and that was too hard. So then he ended up announcing, and he actually kept with, you know, roller derby a lot longer than I did because he loved announcing so much. But we just started up the team and just kind of like learned how to skate. None of us knew what the heck we were doing. We all started on like those $99, like Torques, I think they were called. And some of the Fort Wayne girls came down and like showed us the rules and how to actually play. And then they completely annihilated us in about a couple months after that. It was just this addictive thing immediately. I loved roller derby and it just kind of took off. And I was really fortunate for it to kind of lead me into these other paths in my life, you know, as far as knitting and writing books and doing that kind of thing, all came from my start with Naptown.
So you started Naptown in 2006, if I remember correctly.
I think so.
That's like OG right there. So Derby still had three periods.
Yes. We had three periods. It was really important to have like cute panties at the time. Our fundraising efforts, like to get, like, it's so embarrassing what we used to do to get money. We took like Pringles cans and we decorated them and we'd go to bars on our skates and like shake them at people. I think we had spanking contests, pillow fights. I mean, just horrible stuff. But, you know, it got us the money we needed. And had a lot of rockabilly dudes in the audience back then.
But so it was when great. You I mean, played. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, I just, our first bout was like completely sold out. I mean, and it was thousands of people there.
Thousands of people.
That's
Yeah.
I can't imagine.
When you played roller derby, what was your favorite position to play?
Like the favorite position that I also hated? Jamming. I was always a jammer and I hated it. Like every time I got on that line, I felt like I was going to throw up. My knees would shake. I was just like, why is everybody looking at me? Stop looking at me. And then, you know, that next whistle would go because you had the first single, then the double. Mm-hmm. And then we'd take off. And, you know, once you started, it was really fun and great. But man, like that 5 or 6 seconds that you're standing on the line before that next whistle, I just wanted to throw up every time.
I remember well.
Now tell us a little bit about your name, Joan of Dark. Where did that come from?
You know, there was another name I wanted at first, and it was similar to another girl's, and I asked her and she was like, no. And you know, I was like, okay, that's cool. And actually our other announcer had like a list of names and he was like, what about this one? This one's very you. And I'm like, this is so me. So, I went with Joan of Dark. 'Cause it was, you know, I'm kind of like the quirky goth. Like I always tried to be goth when I was younger. I thought that was really cool. I always said like the Sandman analogy, like in the Sandman comic books, I always wanted to be like Death, right? Like she's cool.
Yep.
But I was,
she's adorable too.
Yeah, but I'm delirium. I'm just weird and I talk too much and I say weird things that pop into my head. So I'm the delirium goth and not the death goth.
Wait, wasn't there a connection with Neil Gaiman?
There was. I want to ask so bad about skating on the House on the Rock. How did you convince your friend to do that? What were you doing at House on the Rock and skates? Was the Dance Macabre playing? There's just so much that I want to hear about. Where did that connection start? Sorry.
If this has ever happened to anybody else, I don't know, but I get really superstitious when I play sports. And not being a sports girl growing up, I didn't know that I was superstitious. But basically, like, I would have the same playlist, the same stickers on every helmet. And I went and saw the movie Coraline, and I'm a huge Neil Gaiman fan. And, you know, a lot of the things in that movie were knit and like made in real life. So I made the little squid guy and I called him like Octo Kitty, and we took him to a bout and I sent him to Neil Gaiman. And, you know, no big deal. And he blogged about it and everything. And then we won that bout that happened at, that I had made the Octo Kitty and then sent it to him. And then the next bout, I didn't do it and we lost. So then I started making them and sending them to him at every bout. And I told him I was sorry. I'm like, I don't mean to do this to you, but like, you're a good luck charm now. And he was like, oh no, if I care about a sport, it's got to be roller derby. And we kind of kept talking. And then he was coming into town to get an award, a Kurt Vonnegut award. And he was like, hey, can I just take the train out to dinner and meet everybody? And we were like, hell yeah, you can. And his assistant and I were talking and setting that up. And I think it was something she said the moment she knew that we were friends was she wrote me and said, hey, Neil wants to take you to dinner. And I just wrote back, holy shit. And then a few minutes later, I wrote back and said, I mean, yes, we would be delighted. And so she and I became best friends after that. So then Neil was doing a thing at House on the Rock. So we went to, like, we were invited to that as well. And, you know, she and I just hung out together and we hung out with him and then ended up like going to parties at his house. And just, he became like I took him to his first derby bout in Eau Claire, which was really cool. And yeah, we just kind of became friends, just this weird. And then I talked his assistant into joining roller derby. She hurt her shoulder too. I think he was a little mad at me about that, but it's going to happen. So yeah, at House on the Rock, we put her on some skates and I taught her to skate at House on the Rock, and like the employees didn't really know what to do because obviously this isn't something that's allowed, but also here's their guest of honor and that's his assistant. And what are they going to say? So
that is so awesome.
It's just that
yeah.
In American Gods, that House on the Rock scene with the carousel, it's the second I read it, I just, it was the brightest scene I've ever seen while reading. So like, he puts that imagery of the dance macabre music in the background, and it's just the neatest. So for me to imagine you convincing someone to roller skate around as well, like, that's in my head now.
I got to ride that carousel that weekend.
That's awesome. Oh, that's
so cool.
Yeah, it was, and they actually, because the only animal that wasn't on the carousel, like in real life, was the wolf. That's the only thing he made up for the book. And so they actually built a wolf for that weekend. And I think it's still there that you can sit on and take your picture with. It's a weird place.
Oh, that's super awesome.
It's so cute. I love it.
Do you have any other derby questions?
I mean, I don't have derby questions.
Okay.
I mean, I can't wait to knit us the mini Jane hat for Christmas ornaments that you have on Knit Picks. I just found it the other day. I don't know how I missed it, but we met because of a Jane hat.
Yeah.
Like, we became friends because of her mom had crocheted her a hat, and it was the first learn to skate I went to where Dee was there.
Mm-hmm.
And, I didn't know anybody, and there was an awkward person who was standing as awkwardly as me in the corner, putting on her skates. And I was like, hey, I like your hat.
And thanks.
That was it.
That was it.
We've been best friends since.
Knitting brings people together.
Yarn. Soft.
Yeah, my husband said, put this on your head, wear this to practice, and if anybody recognizes what this hat is and where it's from, you'll be good friends.
Forever. Our children are going to get married. I mean, not for another 10, 11, 12 years.
Yeah.
You're being so loud in the background right now.
My second book is about knitting and nerdiness. And the publisher, we were trying to convince them, like, yeah, this is a thing. They were like, well, is there really a big crossover between crafting and nerds? And I sent them a picture of a convention where there were like 100 Jane hats in an audience.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, yes, there is.
Well, let's talk about knitting. Let's talk about, you have 3 books out right now. You're working on a 4th book, but let's talk about the first 3. So I have images from all of the covers of the books. So this is, I think, why don't you take it away?
That's from Knockdown.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
It's what I wish I had with
strawberry
ankles.
Yeah, that's strawberry jam, and that is a real broken leg.
Aww.
Yeah. And we knit her a little crutch, like crutch covers, you know, padded cushions for her crutches. Yeah, the first book is called Knockdown Knits, and obviously all roller derby themed. It's kind of a funny story how that happened. We were at a party with another, it was a surprise party, I think, for another derby girl named Scary Poppins. And she had broken her shoulder in practice. And it was like the worst shoulder break I've still seen to this day. I mean, it was hours of surgery for her. Like, it was in pieces, you know. And we knit her like a cover for her sling. And so we're at this party, and I get a little drinks in me. And then I get brave. And I'm introduced to this acquisitions editor at Wiley. And Wiley does like the dummies guides usually. And they also do other, you know, craft books as well. And I kind of went up to him and I was like, you know what you should do is a roller derby knitting book. Look at that thing over there. I made that. Let's do that. And kind of forgot all about it. And a few days later, they tracked me down and called me, and they were like, yeah, put a proposal together. And, you know, because I think we should actually really do a roller derby knitting book. And I'm like, yeah, of course we should. And then I'm like Googling like how to write a proposal, because I've never done this. So we put a proposal together, and it was kind of a hard sell for them at first. I think they were like, roller derby, is that a thing? And it was still pretty new. And we ended up doing it. And it, you know, did pretty well for a knitting book about roller derby. A lot of the facts in there are a little bit outdated now because it does still talk about three periods and how, oh my gosh, you guys are almost 100 leagues now.
Well, we have a question actually in our chat. I would love to know more about this third period situation. I joined after that. I don't get it. And I joined after that too. I don't get it. So I'm with.
You know, it was fun actually. Like, you know, I think it made it a little too long for the audience. But for the team, it was the same length of time. It was just broken down into three sections. So you had like kind of an extra little break. And we always said that like Naptown was a third period team, which we were at the time. We would always be losing in that second period. And then the third period, we would come back and just, you know, win, except against Fort Wayne. But yeah, it was a thing. And I loved it. I loved three periods. So it was kind of hard for me when they went away.
Tell us about this Fort Wayne that we saw.
Oh, so no, it was just a joke. Like
I know.
Loved those girls. But yeah, they did come. Like our first bout, we played Nashville, Tennessee, and just, you know, wiped the floor with them. It was great. And the second bout was Fort Wayne, and they just massacred us. And I think we ended up like beating them the next time or something. But yeah, it was just kind of like a joking rivalry. Like, oh, and I think that was the only game we lost that year. Maybe we lost another one. It was a long time ago. A lot of head hits since then.
But it was, I apologize, you know, if you hear one of my cats in the background keeps crying because it wants out of the.
Oh, yeah, I hear it.
Yeah.
Oh, that was me. Sorry. Oh, I talked to the cats. I don't have.
But no,
cats.
Like
I use hers.
Oreo Slammer, I think. Yeah, Oreo Slammer was like the first derby girl who ever came and like taught us things, and she was from Fort Wayne, and then, you know, beat our asses the next time we saw her.
Those are my favorites, though. Like the other players who will just—I mean, there's no mercy, but. They want to teach you so much. And yeah. So between things, between the jams, they'll be like, hey, I noticed that you've been doing this thing a lot. Like,
yeah. And then they destroy you.
They just still destroy you. Yeah. But then, gosh, we played against Detroit once, the Motown Wreckers. Mm-hmm. And someone just sent us a video of, hey, we noticed you guys are doing this a lot. Because we're a fairly new team. And they taught us so much. Mm-hmm. In this one little video, and it was so generous. We never asked. And it was just like, hey, we want to see you guys kick butt. You have such great spirits. So I love it when teens come together. I'm sorry. I'm a talker too. I can't help myself.
No, it's fine. That's the great thing about derby, I think, is, you know, you can like hate people on the track and then love them off of it.
Yeah.
Like I talk so much smack on the track. Like I am nasty. On the track, but off the track, I really like you.
Well, speaking of off the track and coming together, tell us a little bit about the folks who contributed to Knockdown Knits. Were they all your designs? Because I noticed there was a bunch of different people in the book.
No, there were a lot of the other derby girls contributed patterns, I think. I'm trying to remember because it's been a minute, but I know several of the other girls on the team also wrote patterns for it. And then even if they didn't write the pattern, there were a few that were like, hey, this is a good idea, you know, do something like this. And then it was all Naptown at the time, like as it stood right then modeling. So it was just really fun. Like we kind of went to a roller skating rink one evening and just took all the photos.
I like the bios of the players that you, like after each pattern, there was a little bio of, you know, somebody and they're wearing one of the knits. It's cute.
Speaking of one of the knits, this is one that Sawa made from the book.
This was my carpal tunnel rehab project. It took me forever. I'm normally pretty fast. And this was 6 weeks.
That hat made me so happy because like at the time there wasn't roller derby merchandise. you know, like there was nothing you could wear that like screamed, I play roller derby.
Yeah.
Except, you know, you would meet people and constantly scream at them, I play roller derby, you should too. So like the hat was a good segue. And like, that was one of the first ideas for the book. It was, I think it literally went, arm sling, crutch cover, and then that hat, like the jammer and pivot hats. Just because it was like, it was a cool thing to wear and you could instantly spot like another derby person, you know?
Right. Especially if they're brave enough to wear the jammer star outside of roller derby. Like, hey, you know, this is what I mean, do.
In the grocery store, I mean, this would put me in the mood to grocery shop.
There you go.
Just
make your way through the pack. tell us about your next book. You've got two other books out right now.
Yeah. So then I did Knits for Nerds, which is all knitting and nerdiness, because I grew up like at sci-fi conventions. I was a total con brat. Like my mom started dragging me to those, I think when I was like 5 or 6. And I just kind of grew up with that culture and a lot of craftiness, you know. There's a photo somewhere of my mom handmade these like Star Trek uniforms. Next Generation, the one piece, you know, pain in the butt to pee in. And we have like a family photo somewhere of all of us wearing those. And I thought it was so cool. Like, I didn't know that that wasn't cool. And I would go and tell kids at school, like, yeah, guess what I did? And they're like, nerd. But there's a lot of craft culture in that sci-fi con kind of group. And I kind of wanted to put that into a book where the idea that you see something, you just want to make it. And it was really fun. And actually on the cover right there, that is Michelle Pemberton, a.k.a. Red Rocket, who was one of the original Naptown girls. So she was like our OG pivot for the first two games until she got injured and then became a ref, I think, afterwards. Yeah. So, and I think there's a couple other derby models in there too. Because of course, you know, and actually that book, a lot of it was shot at Neil Gaiman's house. So yeah, there's like a particularly spooky attic picture with Dora the Destroyer that was in his attic. And that was mainly just so Keish, his assistant, and I could hang out for a weekend because we never got to see each other because we were always working in it. I was like, hey, what if I come shoot the, you know, the book up near you? And she goes, I'll shoot it at his house. So we did that. We took like loaded a van full of photographers and derby people and took over his house for a weekend.
That's awesome. But
yeah, it was a lot of fun. Yeah. And she's in the book too, actually, Keish. She's modeling a chessboard, I think.
Oh, the scarf, the big ol'.
Yeah. No, that's the next book. This chessboard was like a bag.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Sorry. I've seen these patterns because I didn't know about the Knits for Nerds or the geek knitting until I went on Ravelry a month ago. And I was like, oh, there's more? There's more.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's again, like if I hadn't done roller derby, I wouldn't have had like this life that happened afterwards, like this weird, strange life of knitting and travel and writing books. Like it's just,
yeah,
it's amazing what happens when you say yes to, you know, putting on skates and fishnets and knocking into people.
The adventures.
Do you have a favorite pattern from that book?
I think maybe the Trek girl dress, because it was very
mine.
Simple. And I've actually, I've got a picture where somebody, they sent it to me. They made the dress and then wore it to meet Patrick Stewart. What's his name? The weird singing guy. He's kind of been problematic as late. The first one, Captain Kirk.
Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah.
You know who I'm talking about.
Yes, we know who you're talking about. Ben Phillison in the chat.
William Shatner.
That's it.
Okay, but yeah, she got a picture with Patrick Stewart and with William Shatner, and I thought that was so fun. So I think like right now that's probably my favorite. And maybe the horrible gloves. I thought those were really fun too. From Dr. Horrible.
Dr. Horrible gloves. Oh yes. My gosh. I love Dr. Horrible. Anything that Joss Whedon does, I'm totally cool with. I've worn out that CD in my car.
Just everything about that book was really fun to do. You know, I mean, they're all really fun to do. They're always stressful at the time. Like, I'll be up all night and asking my husband, like, why am I doing this? And then after it's done, you know, I'm happy again.
The doors that roller derby opens for people just amazes me all the time. Like, when I met Dee, I felt like it began with every time we'd go somewhere, I was like, oh, I know a person in that city from some geeky choir thing or, you know, other geeky thing I did. And now it's not just that. I know a person in the city from roller derby.
Yeah.
And they were my teammate and they moved. And now, I mean, anywhere I go, I have a connection. And I just love that. And it's all walks of life. You know, that's not, it's not just like, you know, the teachers I work with. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you own a coffee shop, retail manager,
choir teacher. Yeah.
It definitely exposes you to, you know, different people than you would probably mingle with in everyday life. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's just, it's a lot of fun. Like I always say, everybody should try it at least for a little bit. I've suckered most of my friends into it. I've got one friend that I'm giving her a pair of skates right now to get her started. I'm like, yeah, I've got some old like Rydell 122s. Those are yours, girl. We're gonna do this thing. You have some aggression to work out.
Are you still volunteering for Naptown?
I'm not right now. We actually kind of joked because a lot of it was I got too busy, and then once I had my kid, like that was just game changer. And then my husband was announcing, and then this year he retired, and then Naptown didn't have a season because COVID.
Right.
So he was kind of joking. He's like, well, I guess this pandemic's my fault. Cause he and his co-announcer had been doing it forever. And they kind of joked like, well, I guess if Naptown couldn't get us, then pandemic.
What is no, his announcer handle?
Dill Hero.
Gotcha.
So yeah, he's done like international derby tournaments and stuff. He's been around. He has a lot of fun with it. And he was pretty sad to be leaving, but it's kind of unfortunate that he's, yeah, that's us watching derby with the horse in the house.
With your pony.
Yeah, you have your pony in the house.
Yeah, like I think Alligator or somebody was saying like, show us your cute pets watching derby. And so we were like, oh, we can one up all your cat pictures. And we took the horse in the house. And
I mean, I have a dog that size. We get a lot of horse jokes.
Yeah.
But an actual horse. And my daughter saw those pictures and see, mom, she can have a horse.
Sorry.
No, it's okay. I had to explain that. You know, you are more awesome than I am, and that not everyone's mom can be that awesome.
I was a persistent 12-year-old. Honestly, like at 12, I just started harassing my parents until they got me. Well, I bought him myself, but they let me have the horse. Mm-hmm. And I've just had him ever since.
He's beautiful.
How old is he?
Thank you. He was born in 91 or 92. So somebody mathed that for me, but he's pretty old.
29?
Yeah, they live a long time.
Wow.
Yeah, that's him. Dr. Hooves.
Oh, what's the fourth doctor?
Let's talk about that scarf. Now, I know the story behind the scarf, but let's just talk a little bit about Dr. Hooves.
I mean, the BBC did release like the pattern a long time ago, just like the number of inches you per like stripe. My hands are doing the talking. I can't think. But
well, it's the way that scarf happened, like the actual first one, and this is, you know, maybe I'm completely wrong and somebody would be like, that's not true. But the story I always heard was that the costume designer or one of the assistants was handed like a basket of yarn and said, make a scarf in these colors, and interpreted that as knit all of this and made like this gigantically long scarf. And brought it to set, and everybody was laughing about it. And Tom Baker put it on and was just like running around in it and was like, no, this is great. and it became a thing. So that's the story I've heard. And I like to think that it's true, because I like to think that I am also that awkward and that would turn into something like awesome.
Awkward can be very awesome if you just give it a chance.
I had to knit the scarf, you know, just to say I did it. And I had to put it on my horse because he's Dr. Hooves.
Oh, so does he wear the scarf often, or was this just for the photo op?
He was just a very good sport for about 45 seconds, and that was it.
Quick, get the hat on.
Yeah, pretty much. The hat was the worst part. The scarf he was all right with, but not so much the hat.
Now, can we find more patterns like this in your next book, the Geek Knits?
So Geek Knits, that one, no Doctor Who scarf patterns, but that one was really fun. We did, I hooked up with Kyle Cassidy, who's this incredible photographer, and met him at Neil Gaiman's house when he was photographing me and several other Derby girls frosting John Scalzi on Neil Gaiman's front lawn. Whole big story to that. But Kyle and I got along really well and decided that we should collaborate on a book. And Kyle is also doing a roller derby portraits book that he's been working on for a few years, which is very cool. Like, he's been traveling around photographing people in roller derby and kind of telling their stories. But yeah, we got like celebrity models, like on the cover. There's Leah Cavoli. She was in Deadwood and did some voices for Robot Chicken. And then Miracle Laurie is, of course, from Dollhouse. And then that is the real, oh goodness, what's that robot's name? I'm about to lose my geek cred.
It's not Tom Servo.
Yes. Tom Servo?
Is that the other one?
Yes.
Tom Servo.
Yeah, so that's, so that's the real
correct
like robot
us in the chat.
But that's
the
really him.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
That's awesome.
That's really Servo. Wow.
Yeah. There were like rules that we had to follow about how we photographed him. Like, you know, like we couldn't actually show anything like below the waist. So yeah, we like flew all over the country, like getting these photos. We got George R. R. Martin to do like a picture with a direwolf, like a knit direwolf, which was also a funny story because I just sent Kyle out for that photo because I couldn't go with him. And every day, like Kyle was there for 3 or 4 days and I was like, did you get the photo yet? And he goes, no, George took us to his movie theater and bought us burritos. And so we were watching a movie and eating burritos. And I'm like, okay. And the next day I was like, Kyle, did you get the photo? And he's like, no, George wanted to write. And I'm like, well, don't interrupt that or else the entire world will hate us.
Gotta finish it.
And then I think, right. I think literally like it was 2 hours before Kyle had to get on a plane and George was like, weren't you supposed to take my picture? And so they went out and did like the photo and Kyle is really annoying because he can get the perfect photo in like 2 or 3 shots and it's just, it is what it needs to be. And he'll take more pictures, but there's no need. Like he's got it. So that was also nice for working with people on tight schedules because Kyle could get the shot quickly and they would always appreciate that.
Now, is Kyle the same photographer helping you with your next book?
Yes.
Oh, the Icelandic sweater book. Tell us.
Yes. So he was in Iceland working on a documentary and he texted me and he's like, yo, what's up with all these sweaters I'm seeing over here? And I'm like, I don't know, man. Those are just like Icelandic sweaters. And he's like, but what's the story? Like, what's the deal? And I'm like, I don't know. So we started looking it up and he was like, let's go to Iceland and find out. I'm like, all right, let's go to Iceland and find out. So get on a plane. We go to Iceland for just a long weekend, I think, to kind of do the proposal. And we just start interviewing people and talking to people and getting these like amazing photos. And I got to like, you know, learn a little bit about what history there is. But it's one of those things where kind of everybody disagrees on what the actual history is of the sweater. And it's something that's very iconic to Iceland. If you go there, like you really do see it. Everybody has, I think everybody has 3 is what we were told. One that they made, one that their grandmother or mother made for them, and one that somebody left after a party. And somebody told us that, and when we kept asking people, like, yeah, we were told this, and they're like, yeah, actually, that's true. And it's one of the ways that, like, you're kind of shown that you're accepted over there. We talked to one girl who married an Icelander and moved there, and, like, the family gifted her with a sweater. Like, okay, now you're family, so here you go. And there's another girl over there who met a guy who had been adopted, I think, and didn't have a sweater, so she, like, immediately made him one. Like, you can't be an Icelander without one. And it's all based kind of around their sheep, because their sheep have evolved over the years to have this almost naturally waterproof top coat. So when you wear an Icelandic sweater knit out of that wool, you know, a lot of fishermen wear them, you don't really get wet, you don't really get cold, and you don't get overheated, which is pretty amazing for an all wool sweater. It's just, it's amazing. And the country is beautiful. Most of the people are really nice. It's just an awesome place to be. So we were supposed to have been there already and be done with this book, but COVID literally shut everything down like a week before we went to fly out. So once that's over, we're going to go out there for a couple weeks, do the entire ring road, do more photos, photograph all the patterns I've made, and do more interviews with people. And then it'll be done.
Have you been keeping in touch throughout during COVID, like we are with video right now?
Yeah, we've actually been filming like some kind of like drunk knitting things that we've been doing. I've been teaching Kyle how to knit via Zoom, which is interesting. And the goal is that, you know, after we do this ring road, he's going to make his own Icelandic sweater. So we're kind of like laying the foundation right now for him. And we've been talking to Icelanders over there. I've just got to like edit all the videos, which I'll get that. And we've just been kind of drinking and chatting via Zoom, and I give him knitting lessons, and occasionally we bring in a few other people and drink and knit with them as well. And we've done like some interviews and stuff just to kind of get as much done as possible, because, you know, obviously like we still have a deadline that our publisher would love us to meet. It made a neat sound when it went by the first time. So yeah, but you know, I'm very lucky to be working with Kyle. Like, I think he and I work well together. He and I both have very creative minds, and then we both are very disciplined about certain things. So I'm very good at like putting together an itinerary and a schedule, and Kyle's very good at like the ideas of who we should be talking to, who we should be meeting with. And then of course the photos, like I wish I could show you guys these photos because they're amazing. You can troll through my Instagram and see some, but not all the ones that he's taken, because obviously we need them for the book, but they're incredible. So I'm very lucky to work with him. Very lucky that he happened to be the photographer that day when we were covering Skullsy and Frosting.
As one
weird
does.
Shit life.
As one does. You know?
It was, so Skullsy is a science fiction writer. He has a really good book called Lock In. I know he has other good books as well, but that's the one I've read. And he was on Twitter and said something like, oh, I'm almost at X number of followers. If I get this many, then I'll do something crazy, like cover myself in frosting naked on my driveway. And Neil Gaiman retweeted it and said, everybody go follow John Scalzi. And he said, you bastard, now I'm using your driveway. So once he hit the followers, he went out there and Kyle took a picture, and it's actually more like the Invisible Man. Like, he's not naked. And we just covered his face, but it was me and a few other roller girls. And we just kind of did that. And I think they sold posters and donated to a cat charity, maybe City Kitties. Aww. In Philly. Yeah, it was really nice. And somebody did a time-lapse video of it, and I felt really bad because it was the first time I met John and I got frosting like inside his ear canal.
Hey, anything worth doing right.
Right. But became really good friends with him. He and his wife are both in Geek Knits, and his dog. So the pictures with like the 20-sided dice, those pillows, those were his. Like, he was really great about it. Yeah, so I end up meeting cool people in weird ways.
I'm very jealous.
I'm not cool enough.
You know what I mean.
And it always sounds like I'm name dropping sometimes, but I'm not. Like, I'm just like, well, this is Kyle. Like,
this is where your path has taken you.
That's amazing.
Awesome. Yeah. And it was just, you know, it was a weird weekend. There were a lot of people there. And you kind of like, you immediately find the people at the party that like you can hang with. And Kyle was one of those people. So we got along really well. And I think I probably got drunk and propositioned him about doing a book that night. I was like, hey, do my next book with me. And he did it. So, I don't like to encourage drinking because everybody should have like their sober moments. But I don't know, whiskey courage has helped me out a few times.
I was going to say, it's landed you a couple of book deals.
It has. Because, you know, I'm awkward and quiet. And when I drink, I'm awkward and loud. And if I'm around other awkward people, then they hear me then and like me.
I just get like verbal, like there's no other term for it. Verbal diarrhea. It just all starts coming out and my hands start going unless I'm knitting. And before I know it, there's like this crowd of people like, oh, tell us more. What weird thing is coming out of your mouth next?
Mumblebee in the chat says, woohoo, awkward crowd.
Go awkward people.
High five.
You know, you have that moment where your brain's like, don't say it, don't say it, don't say it. And then you say it. That's me.
Yeah.
All the time.
Oh my gosh. If I could just take that voice and listen to it, maybe once, I'm also that kind of teacher. Like if I think of something, it just comes out of my mouth and my students are like, what? Where did that come? What? But I get their attention.
Yeah. Let me explain. Here's what I meant. What do you have in your knitting notebook down here, Sawa?
Well, my knitting notebook. I've got some gnomes I'm working on. I don't know. Let's see. Oh, I want the coffee shop. Rage against the bean.
Well, I want to know why she picked Strange Brew, because that's one of my favorite cult classics.
Such a good movie.
I grew up with that movie on Laserdisc, okay? Like, you had to flip it in the middle. Because God love my parents, like, they were always on the cutting edge of the wrong technology. Like,
yeah.
Let me tell you about all my videos on Betamax that I had as a kid. And
my first car had an 8-track player in it. So,
yeah, like, all the young people listening to this are like, what the hell's a Betamax? It was like, you know, it was up against VHS. It was like Zune versus the iPod, you know? I had a Zune too, actually.
Me too.
But yeah, I grew up with Strange Brew on Laserdisc. And, you know, it's just like, it's our cute little quirky coffee shop. Like, my husband worked in IT for years. He was in the military for a long time. And then when he went to civilian life, he went into IT. And I was doing, I don't know, just whatever I did, bouncing around from thing to thing. And I had wanted to open a coffee shop for years. He wanted to open a bar. Luckily, we landed on coffee shop because I don't think I could handle bars. I like people, but when I'm around a lot of people for my job, I want them to shut up and drink their coffee. I don't want them to be loud and like yelling at me. And, you know, listen to covers of Sweet Caroline or whatever. But we ended up doing coffee. And it was just one of those things. Like, I had worked in coffee before, but actually owning your own business is just a whole other beast. I compare it a lot to having a kid. Like, everybody tells you it's going to be hard, but until you do it, it's not hard, you know, like you don't realize. And everybody tells you how your life is going to change, but it really, really changes. And then when other people like talk about their hard jobs, you're like, you don't know, because you don't have a business. But it is like, it's also very rewarding. You know, we've made a lot of really good friends and really good connections. It's just kind of led to this weird life. And again, with roller derby, like, who knows if that would have happened? I'm sure roller derby in Indiana would have happened, but who knows if it would have happened like that? like if we hadn't all been kind of sitting at this table over caffeinated and excited about like, have you seen this show? And these girls put on skates and it's amazing, you know, and just talking and talking. And then of course, SJ Strawberry Jam going like, let me make a MySpace. And kids, MySpace is like Facebook, but for, you know, with music and older and different. But yeah, like she just, she just did that. And then we've seen like all these, like, I really like connections. I like seeing people get from like one point to another. And with the coffee shop, I've literally seen that happen. I've seen people go on their first date, and then I've seen them like, you know, go to prom and through school and go to college and come back and get married and have kids. And, you know, after 16 years, like seeing their kids come in with them who are now like older. I mean, it's just, it's crazy. And I've seen, you know, connections happen, jobs happen. There's a group of people that meet there that are all really good friends, like good friends, the kind of friends that call each other when things go really bad. And they literally are friends because they all happen to come into our coffee shop at the same time every day. And they would just like start sitting at separate tables, and then they would overhear conversations and move closer and closer. And now every day they sit at the same table. I mean, not right now because, you know, COVID, but
right.
But in real, like in real life, that's what happens. And it's just amazing to kind of see these little connections happen and to look back on our lives and be like, I remember when these two first like cracked a joke at each other. And then I remember when they, you know, just became friends. And then some of our customers, like my husband's, he does weddings. He's done weddings for some of the Derby girls before. He has married a couple of our customers. He married, like did the wedding for one of our employees because her wedding got canceled because of COVID. And like, he did a wedding for people that have met at the shop. Like, it's just crazy, you know, like just these paths that happen. I don't know. I'm always a big fan of that. Like just seeing how life works. It's too long to get into now, but my kid literally exists because I told my hairdresser that my IVF failed because my eggs were bad. And she was like, I've got eggs, and gave me eggs. And now I have a daughter. And like, she used those same batch of eggs to like have her daughter. Like, right? It's crazy. There are literally two kids that exist in the world because I opened my mouth to my hairdresser. Like, life is just nuts, and I love it.
Well, Mumblebee in the chat says, you know, that is really beautiful. Their knitting Jedi also said there's nothing better than drinking some wonderful coffee and knitting and playing derby. That's pretty great too.
Right? You need the coffee after a night of derby where you're tired and hurting. But yeah, like we have a lot of knitters that come in the coffee shop.
I need to warm my fingers before I knit anymore because they're so stiff.
Yeah. It's just one of those things, like, right? Like you always picture coffee or tea and knitting like together. Mm-hmm. And then I don't know. So for us, like it's just a big part of our lives. Like we love coffee, like really hardcore love it. We went on vacation to Wisconsin one time and went to 8 coffee shops before we actually like drank a cup of coffee. Like we weren't jerks about it. We would go buy a cup, take a sip and kind of look at each other and then carry our cups outside and throw them away where nobody could see us and then go to the next shop. Like we're very particular. But so for us, a lot of that too was finding a good coffee shop in our town. Like we couldn't do it.
Yeah.
So we had to make one, which again, DIY punk rock roller derby spirit, right? Like it's not there. You make it.
Yeah, exactly.
And knitting.
I can't find merchandise.
So. Just make your own.
Yeah, I think
I couldn't find the right Wonder Woman thing for D.
Well, I'm sure like doing this, you found a lot of like artists and business owners in Derby because it's that same spirit, like the spirit that makes you be like, you know, there's no sport for me in high school or college. Like, let's just make this my thing. And you just create it, you know, you've got to make it happen. And when Derby started, there was nobody like telling us the rules. I mean, there was, but like, people from each of these leagues, which there weren't that many then, had to make the rules. Like they had to make this thing. Yeah. So it's that whole, you know, like I said, DIY punk rock spirit that we all have.
Yeah.
And I think that's what lures a lot of us to this sport.
It's true. My husband calls it being a just one more thing person. Just one more thing. Oh, no, but I also do this. And when I started roller derby, he was like, there are so many just one more thing people. Like, nobody just goes to work.
Yeah, if you didn't have that, then you would be in your basement. Yeah. Because you have to do just one more thing to get it done, right? Or the bout's not going to happen, or the uniform's going to get ordered, or, you know.
Or the sound system's not working.
Yeah, if you hear a weird noise, my senior dog is like making some hacking noises over there. She's fine. It sounds bad. She's like a tiny chihuahua with trachea problems, so she's like,
aww.
Yeah.
As far as your coffee, so I was perusing your site. Do you guys ship?
We do. We ship all over America right now. And that's like, you know, it's been really big for us with like a lot of the shutdowns and stuff. But yeah, we ship all over. We ship our merchandise as well, coffee mugs and shirts and things like that. I'd say like that roast right there is one of my favorites. Okay. So I know there are probably some coffee drinkers who are like total purists. All right. And I used to be one too. If you ever offered me a flavored coffee before, I would have been like, screw you. No. Our flavored coffee is completely different. It's not like if you ever get a flavored coffee and there's an oil slick looking thing on top, like dump it out and run, right? That just means they've dumped the flavor on top of the beans after roasting. What we do is like a power bean infusion. So it's like slow roasted in. So when you drink a cup of flavored coffee, like Rage Against the Bean with chocolate, you're going to taste coffee and then this little tiny aftertaste of flavor. And that's like how flavored coffee should be. So that one's one of my favorites. And then we have like our holiday grog is our most popular. And then probably like the brown sugar cinnamon. And then if you don't like flavored coffee, we have one called a zombie defense. The only thing with that is like usually the darker your roast, the less caffeine, right? And that's like an unknown for a lot of people. Mm-hmm. But zombie defense is a very, very dark roast that maintains more caffeine than even like the blonde roast do. So when you drink it, that's the only one. And keep in mind, I'm like a 9 cup of coffee a day person. The zombie is the only one that like I feel like my heart starts beating. And so if you've got like some heart concerns, don't drink the zombie. But if you want to like literally come back from the dead, like a post derby, you got the crap knocked out of you at the after party, like drink the zombie defense. It's amazing. We made a beer out of it.
This is what I need to order now that I'm back to school.
Yeah, we had a brewery make a beer out of the zombie defense, and we had a party where we tapped it, and we were having to cut people off, and they're getting mad. I'm like, dude, we're not cutting you off because you're drunk. We're cutting you off because your heart's gonna pop. Like it was probably the wildest party we've had. And I mean, we've had parties with like the blow up jousting and naked derby girls like racing cars down my street screaming, "I'm Lee Jammer, bitch." Literally, that happened. But this party was so out of control because people were tipsy and really, really caffeinated. And we were like, we have to cut you off because you're going to die. And it was a good night. But yeah,
I'm fairly certain that when you talked about "I'm Lee Jammer, bitch," every player watching this imagined that one person on their team just zooming down the street naked.
Yeah. I don't want to say who it was on our team.
Oh, no, that's fine. Because, like, but we all imagined ours. Like,
she's like a fire person now and very professional. And I don't want to, you know, in case this gets back. But yeah, everybody who was a skater on our league at that time, who maybe wasn't at this party, knows exactly who I'm talking about. Because she was one of those. She was a great skater, though, like amazing skater. But yeah. Buck naked down my suburban neighborhood racing a car.
I bet she was Lee Jammer.
Always Lee Jammer.
I just love that Sawa's knitting during this interview as well. I just had to bring that
up. I'm caffeinated. I can't sit still.
I'm working on one of the prototypes for the Iceland book, actually, too. It's going to be a Loca Page's sweater dress. Yeah, it's a really pretty blue, and it's going from the bottom up, so then at the top it'll have the yoke, which is what the Icelandic sweater is known for, is their yoke. So they're usually knit in one piece. If it's a cardigan, it's been steeked, which is where you cut your knitting afterwards. Sounds terrifying. It's fine.
It sounds so terrifying.
It does, but it's really okay. Like, the first time I did it, I cried a little, and then I was like, oh, this is easy. But yeah, so it's, you know, mostly Icelandic sweaters are done in one solid piece, and that's what this is. Like, full dress, and then it'll have the yoke pattern, which is just always gorgeous and fun to work on.
What does that say?
Joan just does the stuff the rest of us are thinking, maybe I should do that thing. yes, I agree.
Lydia 100%. Of Skyrim.
Yes.
Yes, that's what it says.
My eyes don't read red very well, and her name
was
Me neither,
that's why I asked you.
You know, sorry. Like, that's just the thing with life, right? Like, you just be nice to each other and just kind of do.
Yeah.
Like, just do it. Yeah. Do things and be kind. And everybody will, like, everything will work out. Don't be kind on the track, like, be an asshole then. But off the track, like, just be nice and do stuff. Like, every time you see an opportunity, just go for it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I'm, like, super positive. I know it gets really irritating for some people, but.
Not no, for us.
One of my students years ago called me ruthlessly and relentlessly optimistic. And there was actually a t-shirt that one of our Derby friends across the state made that said ruthlessly optimistic. And I was like, I need to have it. That's me. It speaks to
my
me.
My friend Akeesh always calls me her little ray of effing sunshine.
Delirious.
Because, like, every time she's down about something, I'm like, well, come on, fuck up. Let's go.
We can do this.
We can do it. Just mess it up a whole bunch until you get it right.
That's right.
Yeah, totally delirium, man. Like, just crazy. Like, just do stuff.
Complete chaos. It all works out in the end. Just right. Don't worry. Just trust me on this.
Well, speaking of end, unfortunately, I know we're nearing the end of our hour time slot. So, Joan, is there anything that you can point us in the direction of to follow you? Maybe give us your Instagram handles. Let us know how we can stalk you a little bit more online.
Yeah, so there's always joanofdark.com. And then on Instagram and Twitter, I am at joanofdarkknits. And, you know, definitely follow me on there, because especially if you're interested in the Iceland book, I'll be working on that a lot. Also at Kyle Cassidy on Twitter. He talks about the Iceland book quite a bit too. And we are, like, inviting people to come and knit with us, like, for these, like, little drunk knitting things we're doing. So definitely get in on that and hang out with us while we're drinking.
As it's virtual, like,
drunk Zoom knitting.
Yes.
Perfect.
It's really fun.
I might just learn now. Maybe you can teach
you
me.
I mean, if you really want, we can just, like, you can crochet a snake. Because you whatever you knit, you're going to have to tear up anyway. Like,
yeah, you don't have to be drinking or drunk. Just don't get irritated with those of us that are.
No. Touche. Touche. Joan, thank you so much for joining. What's that?
Oh, I just said definitely follow us on there and I'll say hi.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Definitely. Joan of Dark Knits on Instagram. And check out joanofdark.com. And Knitting Jedi says, I want to come too.
Let's do it, Knitting Jedi.
Thank you so much for joining us today and allowing. I've had a fun time with the three of us being awkward together on Collab Lab.
Thank you so much for including me, and it has been a delight. So wonderful meeting you.
Thank you, guys.
Joan, I'm going to do my sign off here, and I'll meet you in the green room in just a sec.
All right.
Make sure you follow Joan of Dark Knits on Instagram and Facebook. Like and subscribe to be notified of future episodes. And while you're at it, do us a favor and click those like buttons right here on WFTDA's channel. For you Twitch viewers, click the heart in the upper right corner to be notified when we go live for future episodes. Leave a comment and tell us who you'd like to see featured on the next episode of Collab Lab. I have my co-host Sweet N Sawa here. I have been your host, Diarrhea. Until next time, take care.